Good afternoon, everybody. How's it going? That's good. I'm really hungry. I didn't bring enough lunch today. If I pass out in the middle of the lecture, that's what the problem is. I have low sugar. Tell that to the EMT. When you come down here, that's what my problem is. You Snickers.
Right?
You no, I'm good. I mean, I do, yeah, yes. But I'm good. Very hungry. Okay. My wife says that we're having albondigas for dinner, so that's good. Okay, let's turn this on. The recording failed. Now it's working. Okay. So today we're going to talk about central sensitization. So we talked about peripheral sensitization in the last lecture. Also, I think I told you guys the wrong kind of setup for the changes in the syllabus. So next week, I'm going to be gone on Tuesday, and we're not going to have class at all, as it says on the syllabus. Did I say somebody else was going to come in and lecture? Yeah, that's not true. So don't show up on Tuesday next week, but also don't show up on Thursday, okay? So this is what we're going to do. You guys are going to effectively get 2 weeks off, right? Because the week after is spring break. So don't thank me now, because I'm not done. So you want to have class next week, but what I do want you to do is to read three papers, okay? So the papers are fair game for the exam. I'm not going to ask you, you know, what does Dantrolene mean, and why did they use the concentration that they used, right? But I may ask very general questions about the papers. But what we're going to do is we're first going to go over them today, okay? So I'm going to give you guys kind of my viewpoint on them, and next week I want you to read those papers, okay? And then we will probably come back to them quickly when I come back after spring break, when we all come back after spring break, okay? So the week after spring break, we'll have two lectures that were planned, the two disinhibition lectures. So we'll start with revisiting these papers one more time. And what we're going to do is basically, I'm going to answer questions that you guys have about the papers, okay? So they're all science papers, so they're not very long, but they're fairly dense, okay? All right. And so that week, we'll talk about those papers, and then we'll talk about disinhibition, which I'll introduce the idea of that today. And then the following week, for the last exam, for the last lecture for this part of the course, I told you I was hungry. That part of the course, Blaine Jacobs, who's a postdoc with Greg Dussor and I, is going to give the lecture on microglia and pain, which will be the last lecture of this section, okay? So that's how it's actually going to work. Forget what I told you last time. Okay, so let's start today. So today we're going to start talking about central sensitization. Central sensitization is a loose term that's used in the pain literature to basically refer to any type of plasticity that amplifies pain that happens in the central nervous system, okay? So it can mean many, many different things. We're going to talk about it in the relatively narrow sense of what happens in the spinal cord. So don't let that let you think that other things don't happen in other parts of the brain. I just don't think that we have a solid enough idea of how that actually works to create lectures that would be meaningful, okay? So what we're going to try to do is to kind of boil down the central sensitization into a couple of different areas that is more specific, okay? So we're essentially going to talk about three major things in this little section of this section of the course. We're going to talk about how long-term potentiation in the spinal cord can be responsible for central sensitization. We're going to talk about how disinhibition in the spinal cord can be responsible for central sensitization. And we're also going to talk about ideas about how microglial activation, so activation of the immune cells that are in the spinal cord, can be responsible for central sensitization. That is not an all-encompassing list, but it's what there's a lot of literature on and pretty solid ideas in the field that most people agree on. So that's what we're gonna discuss, okay? Today, we're gonna focus on long-term potentiation. All right, but first we're going to define all these terms, okay? So first of all, we ended the lecture on peripheral sensitization, talking about primary hyperalgesia versus secondary hyperalgesia, and how many experiments have been done in animals and humans showing that primary hyperalgesia seems mostly to be due to sensitization of nociceptors, okay? So that's a peripheral sensitization effect. It may also involve central sensitization, but it has a clear sensitization of nociceptors, and we know this because people have gone in with electrodes and recorded in both animals and human beings from those nociceptors and can demonstrate that they are sensitized, okay? They start responding to temperatures they didn't respond to before, and in some cases they respond to mechanical stimulation that they did not respond to before, okay? The issue with secondary hyperalgesia, which the definition of that is it's the hyperalgesia that occurs outside of the primary area of inflammation, right? And you can measure that in both animals and human beings, at least in experimental paradigms, by looking at what's called flare, okay? So flare is the reddening of tissue that happens with inflammation. We've all seen this if we've had an injury. What is typically used in human experimental paradigms is they inject capsaicin, okay? Has anybody ever actually had a capsaicin injection besides me in this room? No. So what happens when you inject capsaicin underneath your skin is your skin gets very red, okay? And that's called the flare. You also get a bit of what's called a wheal, and the wheal is the kind of puffiness that you get as well, all right? So the redness comes from increased blood flow, and the temperature there actually goes up too. And you can do a relatively nifty experiment where you can inject the capsaicin into your arm and can give a CGRP antagonist and demonstrate that all of that flare is due to CGRP release, okay? And the CGRP comes from the nociceptors, so it's neurogenic, okay? So in the electrophysiology experiments, like the one we talked about at the end of the class the other day, if you go and record from the neurons that are inside the area of the flare, number one, the person will, if you use the same mechanical or thermal stimulation, they'll say it's more painful, all right? So primary hyperalgesia. And you record from the neurons, and you can show that they are more sensitive than they were before, right? But in the area of secondary hyperalgesia, so outside of the area where they have the flare, if you record from, well, first of all, if you touch them with a von Frey filament at a heavy enough gauge or look at thermal hypersensitivity, you can see that the people have hypersensitivity, okay? So they're sensitized, but if you record from the nerves are not sensitized, right? So that means it can't be driven by peripheral sensitization. You still need an input, but something is amplifying that input, okay? And that is was really the kind of first evidence for central sensitization, although I'm going to show you literally the first paper to introduce this concept, which was published by Clifford Wolf in the early 1980s. So that's what we'll start with today. Okay, I think I covered that already. All right, so secondary hyperalgesia versus primary hyperalgesia. The key here is that we know that secondary hyperalgesia is due to central sensitization, all right? Many forms of pain amplification can be due to central sensitization, or central sensitization can be part of it. But you may also have peripheral sensitization, and as I showed you from these clinical studies, central sensitization doesn't mean that pain is just going to arise out of nowhere. You may still need a peripheral driver to make it meaningful. Okay? Sensitization to zero is zero, right? Yes? Okay, good. So if there's no input whatsoever, you may not have any pain, right? If you have pain, the same amount of nociceptors firing could cause much more pain if you have central sensitization, but it doesn't mean that you don't need the input from the nociceptors to cause them. Okay? So secondary hyperalgesia, the reason we talk about this so much is it's a very convenient model to study central sensitization in relative isolation, because you know that there's not peripheral sensitization. In clinical situations, it can be hard to determine whether somebody has primary or secondary hyperalgesia, and it may not even be relevant, really, right? But we use this as an experimental paradigm to understand the neuroscience of all this, which is why we're here. Okay, so I've already talked about this. All right, so let's now focus on this first demonstration of simple sensitization. So this was done by the great Clifford Wolf. He's not the one that calls himself the great Clifford Wolf. That's my name for him. This guy is really a giant of the pain field. He is now the head of the neurobiology program at Harvard Medical School and at Children's Hospital in Boston. So very, very, very well-known neuroscientist in general, but he started in the pain field. He still primarily works in the pain field. And the thing that really made him or launched his career was this paper that has had an impact on the field that is hard to really describe, okay? Fundamentally changed pain research. So he had this idea in these experiments that he designed that the nervous system should change when you have injury. So I think to you guys sitting in this room, that probably doesn't seem like a weird idea, right? Yeah, since I've been talking about it the entire class. But even then, like before you walked into the class, did it seem like a weird idea that pain would involve some kind of plasticity? No, because you know, as neuroscience majors and as people that are interested in neuroscience, actually plasticity is maybe what you guys got interested in neuroscience for, right? But this paper was published in the early 1980s. Long-term potentiation, which is a fundamental principle in neuronal plasticity, was discovered in the 1970s. Okay, so you know this is years after only a few years after we started to really discover the neurophysiological correlates of this. And I think if you would have asked most people, maybe not in the 1980s, but in the 1970s, that were working in this area, does the pain system change, or is it pretty much set in stone, and it has a very specific neurobiology, and the receptors respond in the same way most of the time? I think a fair portion of people probably would have told you it's a pretty static system. And this was actually a pretty foreign concept, which is why it's a single author paper in Nature with only three figures, okay? So what did he do? Well, he basically did exactly what I've talked to you guys about in paper after paper after paper in this class. But this was one of the first times that somebody that did an experiment like this. So he took rats, he anesthetized them terminally, okay? So that he put them to sleep and they're not gonna wake up. He decerebrated them. So he disconnected their brain from their spinal cord by making a lesion at the level of the brainstem. When you do that, you have to keep the animals on life support, okay? So he had them basically was breathing for them. The heart will continue to go, but if you do that, they stop breathing and would die. So he keeps them breathing by putting them on a respirator, and then what he did was a relatively simple burn injury. Yes?
Excuse me, there are lab rat respirators?
Yeah. Yeah. I don't actually have one in my lab because we don't do in vivo electrophysiology anymore, but when I was a postdoc, I used one almost every day. They're great. They keep animals alive very well for electrophysiology experiments. So this animal is on a respirator, okay? So he did a burn injury. He's basically doing electrophysiology. In this case, though, because at that time they didn't have the kind of electrodes that you would need to record from the afferent nerves, what he was doing was recording the EMG response, okay? So what he's looking at here is a reflex. So the EMG is an electromyogram, right? So it's recording the muscle reacting to a sensory stimulus, okay? So essentially what he's doing is recording the withdrawal reflex that would be happening if the animal wasn't anesthetized, okay? So he records the EMG and he looks at whether the EMG gets sensitized. And he does the burn injury and then looked at the site and as well as at some other sites. And what he can show is that the animals become hypersensitive to von Frey stimulation, so mechanically hypersensitive, okay? And it lasts for up to about 24 hours with the burn injury that he used. They also become thermally hypersensitive, and that lasts for about 3 hours, okay? So for these two types of stimulation, there's a window in which he can look at sensitization and see whether it has a peripheral or a central component. So So the experiments that were done were really very easy. One, he was looking at spontaneous activity in the muscle, so seeing if there's probably ongoing nociceptor discharge. And you can see that there is. It gets gradually bigger after the injury. And then you can see again that there's a hypersensitivity. But this is the key part. This is the ipsilateral foot. So this is the same foot in which he did the injury. Okay, but this is the contralateral foot. So what he's showing in this system is that there is a hypersensitivity on the side that had the injury. That could potentially be explained by the nociceptors being sensitized, but also on the contralateral side, where there was no injury at all. That's impossible to explain by the nociceptors being sensitized, right? It has to be some kind of central process. So this was really the first evidence for this. The other type of experiment that they did, and this is just showing you the rate gram for the contralateral and ipsilateral side before or after the sensitization. So you see that it gets much bigger, the response gets much bigger on the ipsilateral side, but also on the contralateral side. The other part of the experiment that's very interesting is what happens when he used lidocaine. So he didn't actually use lidocaine, he used tetracaine, but it's the same thing, okay? So these are for A beta stimulation, A delta stimulation, and then C fiber stimulation is on the next slide. Okay. So for A beta stimulation, you can see that there's really not much sensitization happening, right? So the low threshold mechanoreceptors from the burn injury don't seem to get sensitized, right? And the response doesn't get sensitized. If you look at the A delta fibers, there's a very clear sensitization, right? There's more muscle response to the A delta fiber stimulation. But you can completely block that with the local anesthetic, okay? So this one doesn't seem to have any clear central component to what's going on. Okay? It may have a central component, but it's very dependent on the activity in the peripheral nervous system. What's way more interesting is this. So this is the C fiber sensitization. So you see this starts faster. It's monstrous in magnitude, okay? It's a huge, huge effect, which is consistent with all the stuff I was showing you in the previous slides. Hopefully, injury produces really robust sensitization of these nociceptors. And it's not blocked by the lidocaine. Okay? So he's stimulating in a place away from where they're doing the lidocaine. The lidocaine is given at the site of the burn injury. Okay? So it's presumably blocking the input from the injured neurons. But he's stimulating at the sural nerve, which is some distance away from there. Okay, so the ability to conduct action potentials is still there, but the input from the injury is gone. Right? So what's interesting about this is it does eventually decay. Okay, so he describes that in the paper. I think I have it maybe on the next slide. Yeah, I describe it here. Okay, I'm not going to read that to you, but this does eventually decay. So it has some dependency on continuous input from the C fibers, but there's a very clear response even when you block that, which also demonstrates that there has to be some plasticity in the central nervous system. Okay. So he describes all this here. You guys can read this when you go look at the slides. You don't need to read that, but I am going to read this because this is important. Not that the other's not important, but this is really important. So what he said, and this is the end of the paper, if the changes found here in the flexor reflex parallel changes in the sensory input to the brain, then pain hypersensitivity following injury may be due to changes within the central nervous system as well as at the site of injury. So this is really the first time somebody had brought up this concept of central sensitization. If anybody in this room were to go to a pain physician and ask, you know, why do I have pain after my injury? They will tell you, you have central sensitization. I can almost guarantee you they will. That concept comes from this paper. That is the origin. Okay. So precisely what neuronal mechanisms are responsible for the central changes requires further study, which is what we're going to now talk about. This has been probably the area of most intense investigation in the pain field since this paper was published. So it's almost 40 years now. Okay. So we're going to spend a lot of time talking about those ideas. Where was I? For the central changes requires further study, but the changes in the responsiveness and functional connectivity in the spinal cord found here mean that its activity is determined by previous as well as by present inputs, right? So this was also a really important point, because it suggests that previous injury can change the response to subsequent injury, right? Which is also a really fundamental idea in the field, yes?
So in this experiment, they tried it like the same leg and the opposite leg. Did they try any other places of the rat besides?
No, so the question is, did they do it in the leg or in other places as well? This is a very simple experiment where they just did the injury, it's on the foot actually, and then looked on the other side. This entire paper involved, I think, 8 rats. He could have done it in, you know, 2 weeks. Less, actually. Could have done it in 8 days.
So my question is, like, would besides, like, areas mm-hmm. in that, not the same foot or mm-hmm. the opposite foot, like, anywhere else in the body, would that still be type,
So the question is this generalizable, or is it just something that happens in certain areas?
Yeah.
So I think what we've learned in the 40 years since the experiment was done, that you can demonstrate effects like this essentially anywhere, okay? You can get sensitization in the nervous system by driving nociceptors from any part of your body. So there's evidence from that, from muscle, from skin, from bones, from the viscera, from the dura, anywhere. So, and what we're gonna do is we're gonna talk about the plasticity mechanisms that underlie that, okay? I thought I saw another hand come on. Yeah?
In that diagram, so are they only stimulating the ipsilateral foot of the injury, or are they also stimulating the contralateral?
This one's just looking on the ipsilateral side. The one, the maybe 2 figures back, they did both ipsilateral and contralateral. Okay. This one's just the ipsilateral side. Okay, so what causes this, all right? So that's what we're gonna now talk about. But first, what's the definition now of central sensitization? Well, it's still just as broad as it has ever been. It's simply increased responsiveness of nociceptive neurons in the central nervous system, not any particular place, to their normal or subthreshold afferent input. So this doesn't really tell you a lot about the underlying mechanisms, but the underlying mechanisms are an area of really intense investigation. All right, so what are some possibilities? What could cause central sensitization? I don't think this is an exhaustive list, but this is what the field has focused on primarily over the last almost 40 years now. So one is that it's a change in neural circuitry. So there are ideas about changes in descending modulation, et cetera, or actual physical changes of nerves in the spinal cord, etc. So we'll get to that a little bit on this point as well, but that's not something that we're going to talk about, but I can tell you that, you know, many people are really interested in this, but are looking more in terms of modulatory centers in the brainstem, as well as potentially areas in the forebrain or amygdala that we frankly just don't know that much about, right? So I don't have a lot to tell you about there. Although it could be fun to do a graduate course or something where we looked at that kind of thing. But not conducive to a lecture like this. All right, so another idea is that there's a change in synaptic function. And there's an enormous amount of evidence. In fact, that's what we're going to focus on today. So I'll skip by that because there's a whole bunch of slides coming later. Another idea is that there's a change in synaptic arrangement. So this concept is really driven by the idea that A-beta stimulation can somehow become painful, okay? So the original idea, this was also proposed by Clifford Wolf, actually, and it's a brilliant idea, is that the A-beta fibers that are found in lamina 3 and 4, remember that we talked about when we talked about neuroanatomy, that when you have an injury to the nervous system, that those sprout up into lamina 1 and physically connect to lamina 1 projection neurons. And his lab actually generated some data that would that suggested that that was true, but they later found out that the tool that they had used to do that wasn't specific once the nervous system was injured. So that's been an area of a lot of controversy, but no one has ever really produced a lot of evidence that that is the case. So I think if you ask most people that work in this area now, they would say that this probably does not happen, but what does happen is that the functional connections between those lamina 3 A-beta inputs and lamina 1 change, okay? So This is where the concept of disinhibition comes from, and this is not going to be the major focus for today, but I'll give you just a brief intro to what it means. Essentially, what disinhibition means is when inhibition loses its efficacy, okay? So that's a double negative, and it leads to an excitatory response, okay? So you guys may remember from your other classes that GABA and lysine both rely on chloride to produce inhibition. And if chloride goes into cells, it creates inhibition. But if chloride goes out of cells, it creates excitation. So there can be a shift in chloride concentrations in cells that makes inhibition lose its efficacy. And there's a lot of evidence that that shift in chloride concentration in the spinal cord after injury can drive disinhibition, and that reveals a ability of A-beta fibers to activate the pain system. So we're going to talk about that when we come back from spring break. So today let's talk about synaptic plasticity mechanisms. So we know of two major synaptic plasticity mechanisms in the spinal cord. One is called windup, and the other is called long-term potentiation. Right? So this is all summarized very, very nicely, actually, in this pretty short review written in Science, again, by Clifford Wolf, and also Mike Salter, who is at the University of Toronto. He's the head of research at the Sick Kids Hospital, which is one of the best or foremost research centers for pediatric neuroscience in the world. They wrote this review that's very accessible, actually, and it's posted in the additional reading. So if you're interested in reading something that goes into a little more depth into this, this is a particular good one. But it basically covers these two topics that we'll talk about today, windup and central sensitization. So these two forms of synaptic plasticity fall in different ends of the temporal spectrum. Windup is a very short-term form of plasticity, okay? And long-term potentiation, as its name implies, is a very long-term form of plasticity. How many of you guys are familiar with long-term potentiation, by the way? Most of you, but not everybody. We have some review slides on it before we jump in. Pain part. Okay, so first let's talk about windup. So what underlies windup? So windup is a pretty simple phenomenon that is essentially explained by relieving the tonic inhibition of NMDA receptors. So there are two primary kinds of glutamate receptors that are found in the spinal cord. There are AMPA receptors and NMDA receptors. Okay? And AMPA receptors are activated by glutamate all the time. But NMDA receptors have a magnesium ion that sits in their pore and blocks them unless you get depolarization that kicks the magnesium out of the pore, right? So what that means is that in most situations, NMDA receptors are not active, okay? But if you stimulate nociceptors at a high enough frequency, what you get is a lot of glutamate release in the spinal cord. You get a big AMPA-dependent depolarization, and that depolarization is big enough kick the magnesium block off of the NMDA receptors. Then NMDA receptors just give you a bigger depolarization for the same amount of glutamate, number one. Number two, and probably more importantly, they lead to calcium influx, and they can be phosphorylated by a bunch of different signaling pathways that can augment their responsiveness. Okay? So what that results in is this electrophysiological phenomenon that we call windup. So it's shown here, okay? So if you take a C fiber that's connected to a projection neuron and you stimulate the C fiber at some frequency, you'd imagine that the projection neuron will fire with it, right? With some latency that's due to synaptic transmission. But if you increase the frequency here, what can happen eventually, and this gets beyond my ability to do coordinated hand movements, is that you'll get this one firing and then this will go like this, okay? That's winding. Basically, what you're doing is you're augmenting the response of the second neuron so that it's firing more action potentials in comparison to the first neuron. Okay, so for every action potential you fire here, you fire multiple ones here. That happens because if you get to a high enough frequency, you get enough depolarization through the AMPA receptors to get the magnesium out of the pore of the NMDA receptors, and then you start getting a much bigger response. And that just causes the neuron to fire multiple action potentials, which is what you see here, okay? So Every time that you give more, you get a bigger response. Okay. If these are spaced out by more milliseconds, then you won't get that response. Okay. It's just about how much depolarization you can get, and if you get enough to relieve the NMDA receptors, then they'll start firing more action potentials. Okay. It's a pretty simple process that is almost entirely driven by NMDA receptors. So what can actually kick this off? Well, it can happen through a variety of different mechanisms. It can happen because you activate NK1 receptors or any number of things, okay? So it is probably the case that you can see wind up happening in clinical pain disorders, but the fact of the matter is people don't really pay that much attention to it. It's mostly thought of as being a type of short-term plasticity. People in the field may be missing something really important by not studying it more, because if you think about it, right, if you had wind up in these neurons all the time because the NMDA receptors were phosphorylated or in a different state, or you change the resting membrane potential so that there's a little bit more depolarization in those neurons, it could be pretty important, right? Because every time you fire an action potential in the C fiber, you can get 5, 10, 15, 20 action potentials in second order neuron, okay? So, but it's just not very widely studied except experimentally. Yes?
Has anyone ever tried to just give more like exogenous magnesium to try it?
To try to suppress it?
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, I don't know. That's a good question. So Hyun's question was, has anybody tried to give more magnesium to try to block this? So I don't know that it would work, because if you just had the depolarization, I don't know that you can overcome that with more magnesium. Yeah. I don't know. It could be if you could actually overcome the depolarization induced relief of the magnesium block by adding more magnesium, theoretically it would work, right? I don't actually know if that works though. Yeah, okay. Good question. You should go look that up and tell me later. All right. So now that's all I can really say about wind up. Wind up occurs, it's very easy to observe experimentally. Okay, you can do perceptual wind-up in humans. It's very easy to do. So it's a very robust phenomenon, but it's not very widely studied, and its contribution to clinical conditions is not very well known. All right, so now let's move to LTP. So the reason LTP is so important is because this is the primary neurophysiological mechanism through which neurons change their responsiveness over a very long period of time, okay? So at least their synaptic responsiveness. So this is from the original paper that was published in 1973 by Bliss and Lomo, okay, in the Journal of Physiology, that described LTP. This was, though, not in the done in the spinal cord. This was done in the hippocampus, right? So what they demonstrated was that if they stimulated the perforant path, which is an afferent pathway into the hippocampus, that if they were stimulating at a certain low frequency, that they didn't see any change in the synaptic responsiveness in the hippocampus. But if they took the stimulus frequency up, what they called tetanization, and what everybody calls tetanization now, so stimulated like 100 hertz, the perforant path, that what that did was it changed the responsiveness. So it increased synaptic efficacy. And then from that single event, that single plasticity-inducing event, that this did not decay, right? And that's how it got its name. So it's potentiation because it's a potentiation of the synaptic response. And it's long-term because it lasts for a very long time. In fact, it seems in some circuits to be permanent. So if you induce LTP, it theoretically doesn't go away. So this concept, first introduced experimentally in the 70s, is now a leading model for how learning and memory occurs in the central nervous system. Okay, so there's a lot of evidence that learning induces LTP in the hippocampus, the cortex, other places, and that may well be how you encode certain types of memories. Maybe not all memories, but certain types of memories. Okay. All right, so we normally think about LTP as being a beneficial process, but LTP can probably also be pathological, and that's what we're going to talk about in terms of pain. But first, let's give a little bit better introduction to LTP. All right, so first of all, this is essentially showing you exactly the same thing that was in that figure, just with prettier pictures. So if you stimulate the perforant path, you can get, with high-frequency stimulation or tetanization, you can get a potentiation of the synaptic response. It's pathway-specific, so if you study a set of neurons that's receiving input from one pathway and another one from another pathway, you will only induce LTP in what's called a homosynaptic mechanism, so it doesn't spread from one synapse to another. It's specific for the synapses that are activated. That's probably pretty important, right? Because if you're trying to learn something, you don't want to learn everything that's happening around you. You want to learn the specific thing that you're trying to concentrate on, right? If you want to know where the gas station is, you don't want to know where the grocery store and all the restaurants in the area are at the same time. Okay, so this is basically a diagram of the previous one. So how does it occur? Well, we know that LTP, in most situations, is dependent on two major things. It's dependent on activation of NMDA receptors, and it's dependent on calcium signaling processes. Okay, so the NMDA receptor activation seems to be required in many instances because the NMDA receptor activation is how the calcium gets into the cell in the first place. So remember that most AMPA receptors are, while they're cation channels, they're permeable to sodium, right? But NMDA receptors are permeable to sodium and calcium. And the reason that calcium is important is because calcium is a metabotropic signaling molecule that activates certain kinases. And the kinase that is probably the most important for long-term potentiation is a kinase called CAM kinase 2 alpha. And CAM kinase 2 alpha, very simply put, is a kinase that is activated by calcium. All right? So NMDA receptors get activated. They allow for calcium influx. CAM kinase 2 alpha gets activated. CAM kinase 2 alpha then phosphorylates AMPA receptors, and that increases their responsiveness. So that makes the synaptic efficacy better. That causes the potentiation. So in the short term, at the start of long-term potentiation, what you get is enhanced AMPA receptor responsiveness because they're phosphorylated. What happens over the longer term is you start trafficking more AMPA receptors to the postsynaptic membrane. So first, you augment your synaptic response by phosphorylating the channels and making their currents bigger. But over the long term, you just insert more AMPA receptors into the membrane, and that gets you a bigger responsiveness. Right? So that leads to the increase in synaptic efficacy. And through some mechanism that nobody still really understands very well, that increase in AMPA receptor trafficking is sustained over a very long period of time. All right, so here is shown in cartoon form, right? So if you activate only your AMPA receptors, that just leads to sodium influx. That's not necessarily sufficient to kick off this process. But if you get a lot of glutamate release, like with tetanic stimulation, then you get enough sodium influx to cause a big enough depolarization to kick the magnesium out of the pore of NMDA receptors. Then your calcium comes in. Your calcium then kicks off these metabotropic signaling processes that involve CAM kinase 2 alpha and AMPA receptor trafficking, and that augments the synaptic responsiveness, which is all shown here. So CAM kinase 2 alpha turns on, protein kinase C probably turns on as well. They're both activated by calcium. Phosphorylation of AMPA receptors and insertion of AMPA receptors. Okay? So that's LTP in a nutshell. So what's interesting about synapses in the central nervous system is that they can undergo two major forms of long-term synaptic plasticity. They can be potentiated, but they can also be depressed, right? So you can decrease the synaptic efficacy. And that is called long-term depression. And long-term depression also depends on NMDA receptors and calcium influx, right? But the idea is that the kinetics of the calcium influx between LTP and LTD are fundamentally different. All right? So with LTP, you get a rapid spiking increase in calcium, and that rapid influx of calcium has the right kinetics to activate CAM kinase 2 alpha. But in LTD, you get a relatively low and sustained influx of calcium, and that calcium influx is about the right kinetics to activate a phosphatase. Right? So remember, kinases add phosphate groups to proteins, right? Phosphatases go off and remove phosphate groups from proteins. So if you phosphorylate AMPA receptors, you make them more active. If you dephosphorylate them, you make them less active. Right? It also seems to be the case that if you turn on these phosphatases, that you remove AMPA receptors from the postsynaptic membrane. Right? So activating the kinases puts more AMPA receptors in the postsynaptic membrane. Activating the phosphatases removes the AMPA receptors from the postsynaptic membrane. Okay? So the particular phosphatase that we talk about here is calcineurin, okay? And it just also happens to be a calcium-activated phosphatase. So in synapses in most of the brain, it seems that there are calcium-activated kinases and calcium-activated phosphatases, and the kinetics of the calcium influx are going to activate them differentially. A big, rapid influx of calcium activates the kinases. A relatively sustained and smaller influx of calcium activates the phosphatases. Okay? One of them biases you to potentiation. The other biases you to depression. Okay, so you're probably asking yourself, why am I talking about all this in the course? Well, the point is coming. So, and this is it. So, Mark Baer, a very well-known neuroscientist, described this in the 90s. So, and he discovered long-term depression. So, Bliss and Lomo discovered LTP in the 1970s, and then Mark Baer discovered LTD in the 1990s. And what Mark Baer found that was that if you stimulate synapses at low frequency, that you get long-term depression. Okay, so the low-frequency stimulation between 1 and 10 hertz is about right to get the right amount of calcium influx to activate the phosphatases and induce the long-term depression. He didn't know it was the phosphatases at the time, but we know that now, okay? Whereas high-frequency stimulation, which Bliss and Lomo had already shown, is about the right frequency to induce lots of calcium influx and activate the kinases and give you LTP, right? So that's shown here. So you have this kind of curve, right, where at stochastic frequencies or at very, very low frequencies, nothing happens. And then if you stimulate at low frequency, regular low frequency, 1 or 3 hertz, you get depression. At some point, this inverts, and then you go back to getting potentiation, right? All right, so this is in hippocampus, cortex, etc. Now, you guys remember back to the first part of the course when we were talking about basic nociceptor physiology. What is the normal firing frequency of nociceptor? Anybody remember? Let me ask the question in a slightly different way. What is the major multiplicated sodium channel in nociceptors? Yes, you know that. NaV1.8, everybody knows. By the way, Armin Akopian is coming, and he did agree to do the interview thing in class. So we're going to do that on April 7th, I think. I'm excited about it. What you guys are about. It's going to be fun. Okay. So NaV1.8, right? All right, so do you remember, does NaV1.8 open and close very rapidly? Or when it opens, does it stay open for a long period of time because it has a relatively slow inactivation rate? It's I heard half rapid and half slow. Who says NaV1.8 stays open for a long period of time? Who says that NaV1.8 opens and closes really rapidly? NaV1.8 stays open for a really long period of time. Is the answer. All right, so if you have a cell that has voltage-gated sodium channels that stay open for a really long period of time, what do you think the firing frequency of that cell is going to be in most situations?
Low.
You're right. Because it just can't fire a lot of action potentials, right? What you really need are voltage-gated sodium channels that have very rapid inactivation if you're going to fire at 100 hertz. Nociceptors don't have that. So, did this jog anybody's memory and now you remember the average firing frequency of nociceptors?
5 to 30.
A little lower, but you're close. So like maybe 1 to 5, right? Okay, so they fire at relatively low frequency. All right, so I've spent the first part of this lecture saying over and over and over again, we're gonna talk about LTP in the spinal cord, okay? The input to the spinal cord falls into the LTP range. Look at the slide. No, it's in the LTD range, right? Okay, so let's go through this carefully because this is really a very important point, okay? LTD is occurring when you have a firing frequency above 10 hertz, probably closer to 50 or 100 hertz. How often are nociceptors firing at 50 to 100 hertz under natural conditions? Maybe never, okay? But I've been telling you, LTP in the spinal cord, LTP in the spinal cord, not LTD in the spinal cord, LTD in the spinal cord, all right? So at 1, 2, 3 hertz in most synapses in the brain, what do you get, LTP or LTD? That's LTD, okay? So this is the percent change in the synaptic response. So this direction is depression, this direction is potentiation. So based on the principles that we know for synaptic plasticity in the brain, you would probably hypothesize that if you were going to stimulate C fibers at their normal firing frequency and record from a projection neuron, you would get LTD, right? Not LTP. So what's the difference? That's what we're going to at least try to talk a little bit about today, right? Okay, so this was the, yes?
Are the eight deltas a little bit faster in their firing rate?
Yeah, so eight deltas can fire at higher frequency. A beta certainly fire at high frequency.
So if you were to stimulate at a higher frequency, mm-hmm. would you not induce LTP with the eight deltas?
All right, so we're actually gonna talk about that in these slides, okay? Yeah. So first of all, you can make C fibers fire at higher frequency, okay? And they can sustain short bursts at high frequency, but their natural rate of firing, if you were to go find a chronic pain patient, okay, who has a neuropathy, and stick a micro-neurography needle into their, let's say they have phantom limb, right, and they have a neuroma at the end of their phantom limb, you probably make a pretty good guess that that neuroma is the source of their chronic phantom limb pain, right? Stick a needle into that neuroma and record from single units, and what you're gonna see is that they're firing between 1 and 5 hertz. Jordi Serra, this very famous Spanish electrophysiologist, has made a career doing this. And paper after paper after paper, they're firing at about that frequency, okay? So the natural firing frequency of these neurons seems to be about that range, okay? So that question is a great segue, right? So that really was what underlies these three papers that I want you guys to read, but we're gonna talk about today. What time is it, by the way? Not going as fast as I anticipated. All right, that's okay. It's not all your fault. All right. It's mostly your fault, but not all your fault. Okay, so Jürgen Sandkuhler was interested in this idea that LTP could underlie pathological pain, all right? But I think he was acutely aware of this kind of question. So they did a number of experiments over several years that address this. I think we'll get through the first two papers and we'll leave the opioid paper probably for when we come back, all right? But read all three of them. They're all there, and they say same cooler LTP paper. They're all in a row, okay? In eLearn. All right, so what did they do? Well, first of all, they labeled projection neurons so they knew that they could record from projection neurons, okay? So they injected a retrograde tracer into the parabrachial nucleus. Remember we talked about these neurons send a projection to the parabrachial nucleus. And they also injected some into the periaqueductal grail, although that comes in the second paper, okay? So these nociceptors send this projection into either the parabrachial or the PAG that allows you to label them so you can see them and record from them, okay? So in this paper, what they did was to record from these and see if they could see LTP. But what they used was high frequency stimulation, okay? So they used the classical conditioning experiment that's used in the rest of the brain. So these neurons, you can get nociceptors if you activate them at high frequency. They will fire action potentials at high frequency. That's just not what they do with natural stimulation in vivo. Okay, you can make them do it, but they don't like to do it. So what happens? Well, we get a LTP, okay? So high-frequency stimulation in the spinal cord, or C fibers induces LTP in projection neurons in the spinal cord. Most unidentified neurons, which are interneurons, you don't see LTP, right? So it's this phenomenon seems to be relatively specific for projection neurons. And what are its mechanisms? Well, first of all, most of these neurons, at least their labeling, express the substance P receptor in K1. They can block the LTP within K1 receptor antagonists. They can block them by blocking calcium signaling with BAPTA. Okay, so BAPTA is a calcium chelator that just basically soaks up calcium, so it gets rid of the calcium. So LTP in the spinal cord is dependent on calcium, just like LTP basically everywhere else that people look. It's also dependent on phospholipase C. This is involved, if you remember, in liberating calcium from intracellular stores because it activates or liberates IP3. It's also blocked by an IP3 blocker, okay? So blocking IP3, which is liberated by phospholipase C, blocks this. So it depends on calcium influx from outside the cell, but also depends on calcium release from intracellular stores. So you need two sources of calcium to make this happen. And it's blocked by NMDA receptors, okay? So at least this form of LTP in the spinal cord is very, very similar to what you see in most other places in the central nervous system, okay? So this was the first paper that they published. It's a very simple paper, okay? It's like 3 pages. It's very easy to read. And it basically lays out the case that LTP is not just about learning and memory, but it's also about sensory learning, okay? And in this case, it probably is pathological and may be the a very good explanation for many types of hyperalgesia, because you're just increasing the response that you get in the central nervous system. And remember, these spinal cord projection neurons are sending the primary signal on to the rest of the brain that's then going to distribute everywhere else, right? So if for every action potential from a C fiber, you end up getting 3 action potentials out of one of these projection neurons, that's a pretty big amplification of the signal as it comes into the CNS. Okay, so the problem with this is, number one, in that first paper, all they did was record from parabrachial neurons. They didn't look at the neurons that send a projection to the PAG. Okay, so that's one. But the key problem is that they did high-frequency stimulation, and that's not the natural way that the nociceptors are going to be firing, right? So you would imagine, again, based on what we know about LTP and LTD in the central nervous system and the rest of the brain, that if you fired action potentials by nociceptors at their normal firing frequency, that you would not actually get LTP, you would get LTD, which you would imagine would actually decrease pain sensitization, right? Okay, so that then was what the second paper was about. So they expanded the second paper to look at the parabrachial projection neurons and the PAG projection neurons. And then they stimulated at both low and high frequency, okay? So retrograde tracers either into the parabrachial nucleus or into the PAG, and then you record from those two types of neurons in the spinal cord. And so this is the key figure. So here are the spinoparabrachial neurons at either high frequency or low frequency stimulation. And here are the spinoperioperductive gray neurons at high frequency stimulation or low frequency stimulation. So high frequency stimulation is 50 to 100 hertz. This is closer to 1 to 3 hertz. All right. So spinoparabrachial neurons looks kind of like what you would see in most of the rest of the central nervous system. With high frequency stimulation, you get LTP. With low frequency stimulation, though, there's no apparent LTD. So that's one difference already. But this is the really key and very striking difference, and the reason the follow-up paper was published in Science. If you record from the spinoPAG neurons, high-frequency stimulation doesn't actually cause LTP in those neurons first. Okay? And then second, low-frequency stimulation, which in most other synaptic arrangements anywhere else in the CNS is going to cause LTD, causes a very robust LTP. Okay? So that's now nociceptors firing at their natural frequency, causing a really robust potentiation of a synaptic response. All right, I'm actually going to not go over this slide right now and skip to the next one. So they did then two additional key experiments. So one of them is to give a kind of natural stimulation. So rather than electrically stimulating the C fibers, they used two chemical stimuli that cause nociceptors to fire at about this frequency and that don't activate other cell types because it's not electrical stimulation. So capsaicin, as you guys hopefully recognize very well by now, is a very specific activator of nociceptors. Okay? So if they inject capsaicin, which causes the nociceptors to fire at roughly this frequency, and record from the PAG projection neurons, they get a very robust LTP. And they also injected a concentration of formalin, which we now know activates TRPA1 relatively specifically. So it's a separate set of C fibers, but that also causes LTP in those PAG neurons. Okay, so natural stimulation causes LTP. And then here's the low frequency stimulation again. And here the key thing is they're asking, is this low frequency stimulation induced LTP dependent on the same type of signaling factors that we've been talking about? So the previous slide actually contains some pretty complex experiments that I don't want to go over right now, but we'll get to it after you guys have read the papers. That essentially shows that this is a calcium dependent process. Okay, so number one, this low frequency induced LTP is calcium dependent. And number two, it's NMDA receptor dependent. Okay, so it requires activation of NMDA receptors. And interestingly, it also involves nitric oxide signaling. So Sankuler's lab has actually spent a tremendous amount of time studying nitric oxide signaling and synaptic plasticity in the spinal cord. It seems to play a really key role in this low frequency induced LTP in the spinal cord. Okay, so it's dependent on this gas that acts as a signaling molecule. All right, so nociceptors firing at low frequency can induce LTP. All right, so how much time do we have? We got enough time, I think. Yeah, all right, so we got 15 minutes. So let's go through this quickly, and then we can come back to it after 2 weeks after you guys have read the paper, okay? All right, so I think we've talked about a couple times in this class that opioids, well, more than a couple times, that opioids are powerful analgesic molecules, right? They're indispensable drugs for treating acute severe pain. There's no substitute for them. There may well never be a substitute. But opioids can do relatively detrimental things. And if you ask an anesthesiologist who may use very powerful opioids like fentanyl or remifentanil, which is used in this paper, they will probably tell you that while remifentanil and fentanyl are extraordinarily powerful treaters of acute pain right after surgery, that when their patients come off the remifentanil or fentanyl, that they get a rebound hypersensitivity. So the pain actually gets much worse after the fentanyl goes away, okay? So that rebound hypersensitivity is sometimes referred to as opioid-induced hyperalgesia. But it doesn't have any, or before this paper, it didn't have any clear electrophysiological explanation, okay? So their idea in these studies was to test the hypothesis that while opioids may cause a really robust inhibition of signaling in the spinal cord at first, that when you take them away, there's a rebound LTP that's induced by opioid receptor activation. Right? So they started their experiments by using DAMGO. DAMGO is not a clinically used opioid, but it's a peptide that's fairly specific for the mu opioid receptor. So it's a good tool to use in experimental situations because it's relatively specific for the mu opioid receptor. We also have some relatively specific mu opioid receptor antagonists, including this one, beta FNA, as it's always called. That's one word I can't actually pronounce. Flunitrexamine. Anyway, everybody calls this thing beta FNA because nobody can pronounce it. All right, so DAMGO is a mu receptor agonist. Beta FNA is a mu antagonist. Okay. All right. So first of all, note what happens if you record from spinal cord neurons, projection neurons, with C-fiber stimulation with DAMGO. Right. So when you apply the DAMGO, you get a nice inhibition of the response. Right. This is very consistent with the analgesia that we all know that opioids create. But when you take away the DAMGO, okay, what happens? It doesn't go back to baseline. You actually get a potentiation. So there's this rebound increase in synaptic efficacy. It looks like LTP. Okay? So here, they're doing a very similar experiment. They take away the DAMGO. You get LTP in some neurons. There's another subset of neurons that you don't see the LTP, but there's a clear subset where you get LTP. It is dependent on the mu opioid receptor. And interestingly, it depends on a postsynaptic response. So this experiment is an interesting one. What they did was they gave DAMGO and then put GDP beta S in the patch pipette from the neuron they're recording from. So anybody know what GDP beta S would do? Okay, so that's fine. GDP beta, so how do G-protein coupled receptors signal? Through G-proteins, right? Okay, so what do G-protein alpha subunits do? Fundamentally, they bind what? GTP. GTP, right? Okay, so in order for G-proteins, alpha subunits of G-proteins to signal, they need to get activated by the receptor, right? And when they get activated, they exchange GDP for GTP, okay? When they become inactive, they hydrolyze the GTP, right? It goes back to GDP, all right? GDP beta S binds irreversibly to the alpha subunit and doesn't allow it to bind GTP, okay? So what they're doing in this experiment is they're only inactivating the G proteins in the cell that they're recording from because they put the GDP beta S into that cell through the patch pipette, okay? So the cell they're recording from, they're blocking the mu opioid receptor, but when they put the DAMGO in, the presynaptic receptors can still be activated because there's no GDP beta S in the presynaptic side. So what this shows is that the inhibition is due to the presynaptic receptors, okay? But the potentiation is due to the postsynaptic receptors. So the inhibition comes from the presynaptic mu opioid receptors that are expressed by the nociceptors, but the potentiation comes from the mu opioid receptors that are expressed on the postsynaptic cells in the dorsal horn. Okay? So it's blocked, as you might not be surprised anymore, by NMDA receptors. Okay, so that the potentiation is blocked by that. So see, the inhibition is still there, but now we get an inhibition of the potentiation. It's gone when you block NMDA receptors. It's calcium dependent. This is just a fancier way of doing the exact same thing. It's really completely calcium dependent, okay? So it's postsynaptic, depends on NMDA receptors, and it's a calcium dependent process. All kicked off by mu opioid receptors, these supposedly inhibitory receptors. So here are another series of experiments, but rather than using DAMGO, they use the compound that's the culprit, okay? So again, anesthesiologists are very well aware of this problem. They use remifentanil. How many of you guys are familiar with these different opioids? Maybe a couple, more than a couple, but okay. So the general concept behind the use of fentanyl and remifentanil and compounds like them are that they're extraordinarily potent, okay? These are actually the compounds nowadays that people that abuse opioids and are dying of overdoses, this is what they're dying from. And the reason they're dying from it is because you make the slightest miscalculation in your dose and you can completely suppress your respiratory centers, right? Yeah, the EMS guy is agreeing. He's been nodding his head for a while, actually. So the other thing that is very nice, so you don't need very much of these compounds to work, okay? They're formulated to go in IVs, so anesthesiologists are using IVs to do everything that they do while your surgeon is doing the other stuff, and the anesthesiologist is keeping you asleep and hopefully comfortable, right? And the other thing that's nice about fentanyl and remifentanil is that these compounds have very, very rapid half-lives, okay? So they're around as long as they're in the IV drip. When you stop the IV drip, they're pretty much gone. If you get a little too much and the person starts to get respiratory depression, you just turn off the drip. You usually don't even have to do anything. The remifentanil's gone soon enough, all right? So they're very, very useful compounds for the situations in which they're used. They're also extraordinarily powerful analgesics, okay? The problem with them is when people wake up and they take the remifentanil away, they get this rebound hypersensitivity, and they often start shaking also. So how many of you guys had a surgery? I'm asking lots of questions. So how many of you had fentanyl and woke up from your surgery shaking like a leaf? I did too, right? So that's part of the symptoms from the basically withdrawal hypersensitivity from fentanyl, right? So the question is, why on earth does it happen? And can we do anything about it to block it, okay? So that's what they tried to go about here. So they showed, number one, remifentanil causes very robust inhibition at first. Second, you take it away, very long lasting augmentation of the response, okay? But look at this, this is the key. So if you just put on remifentanil and abruptly take it away, you get a big rebound response. But if you put on remifentanil and just taper it, the LTP is completely gone, right? Easiest thing ever to tell the anesthesiologist to do. Just taper the remifentanil and you won't get this big rebound hypersensitivity after you take it away. So I don't know that this actually changed clinical practice very much, but my understanding is that most people do this now, right? Paper was published in Science demonstrating that you could, you know, improve clinical practice, and many people started doing it. My surgery happened before this paper was published, unfortunately. Yes? Okay. All right, so it's also mu opioid dependent, it's NMDA receptor dependent, it's PKC dependent, it's dependent on these intracellular calcium stores, so it's calcium dependent. It's interestingly not blocked by CAM kinase 2 alpha. So CAM kinase 2 alpha is involved in LTP and most other places in the CNS, but not apparently in this particular situation. So the big theme here is that LTP in the spinal cord is somehow different than it is in many other regions of the brain. It's pretty specific for these projection neurons that are receiving C-fiber inputs, probably the ones that go to the PAG more than the ones that go to the peribrachial nucleus, but that may not be the same in all species. Low-frequency stimulation can induce LTP in these neurons, which doesn't seem to happen in most other places. And these inhibitory receptors can also induce LTP. But luckily, you know, for the clinical situation where these are used most frequently, there's a really simple solution. Just taper the drug, right? It's dependent on the same signaling processes, more or less, than it is everywhere else. It's an NMDA receptor dependent, calcium signaling dependent process, right? All right, so I hope that these, going through the papers now is gonna help you guys when you read these, right? And what I wanna do when we come back from our 2 week break is that you guys will have questions about the papers and we can go over some of the finer details and the reason the concepts are important. If you're feeling really ambitious, there's another paper on glio LTP from San Cluter's group that came after this. So there's a series of four science papers from them about this LTP, and the glio LTP gets into something that we'll start talking about when we come back from break. Okay? Alright, I already talked about that. And this is what we'll come to after the break. All right? Okay. I think that's it. Yeah. Any questions? All right. I'm going home to eat dinner. One question. Yeah. Okay. So the question was, can I clarify the pre versus post synaptic part of this? All right. So that's what this experiment here shows. All right. So you have mu opioid receptors in nociceptors, where they're found on their presynaptic terminals as well as out in the periphery. And you also have mu opioid receptors on projection neurons in the spinal cord. So the presynaptic ones are the ones that are expressed by the nociceptors. The postsynaptic ones are the ones that are expressed by the spinal cord neurons. Okay? So in the experiment here, what they're doing is that they're recording from the spinal cord neuron. Okay? They're putting a pipette onto it to record. And in the pipette, they put GDP beta S, which blocks the G protein signaling. Okay? So when they're doing the recording, the mu opioid receptors postsynaptically are completely inactivated, but the presynaptic ones are still active because they haven't been exposed to GDP beta S. Right? All right. So what they see is that the inhibition is still there, okay, so that must be presynaptic, but the potentiation is completely gone, so that must be postsynaptic. So it's a different pool of mu opioid receptors that causes these effects, because if you block the mu opioid receptors, you get nothing, right? So the presynaptic ones are at least in this neurophysiological experiment, are producing the inhibition, and the postsynaptic ones are causing the potentiation. Okay? Anything else? All right. Everybody have a